Thank you.
So, for the purposes of this evening, what shall we refer to this book as?
Bucky fucking Dent.
There you go.
I mean,
now, don't hold back.
I won't.
Bucky fucking Dent. By the way, not well known, the original title of The Grapes of Wrath. Who knew?
Yeah.
Who knew? This was originally a screenplay.
Yeah.
But the idea, how long has it been in the works?
I think I started after I made a movie called House of D that I wrote and directed in like 2000 Thank you, but I didn't really say it for that.
You know what?
I made a movie called House of D in 2000.
No matter the reason, like they say in baseball, they're all line drives in the box score.
That's right.
You know, no matter what the reason,
that was
a dribbler.
And so I wanted to continue to write and direct films. That's kind of where I saw the next phase of my career. And I was just searching around for an idea to be the next one. And so it was that summer, and as I've told the story, I was vacationing in Massachusetts, and there were these guys working up on the roof, and I just heard one of them say, I just heard Bucky fucking Dent, just on the breeze, you know, and it made me laugh, and I was very happy just to walk around saying to myself, Bucky fucking Dent. It was like a mantra that worked.
Mm.
And then, I had this idea of, and then just all the ideas that are in the novel, that are in the screenplay, just started to coalesce. One was that a character had kind of a physical state that was dependent on the Sox doing well, and that another character would fake those outcomes if the Sox started to tank, which is what they did that season. So I liked that idea. I liked the idea of somebody being able to fake it, because it was 1978, it was before Sports Center, it was before 24-hour news, you could actually fake something and get away with it. and then there was the final thread that brought it all together was this thing that had happened to my wife and I, where our daughter, when she was 9 months old, got very ill, just her first cold, and she had RSV and double pneumonia, and she went into the hospital, and she just had her first cold. And it was devastating to us because we, as I said, her first cold, and we just like, oh my God, now she's in intensive care, and we could lose her. It just felt like we might lose her. And I would go home, and I would have this vision of losing my daughter at that point, and I couldn't face it. I thought that I couldn't do it. I didn't think it was possible.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think I was strong enough to survive her if she didn't survive. And she's fine. She survived. She's fine. She's going to be 17 next week. And I felt for a couple months after that, she came back home, I felt I was tentative in connecting with her. I'd been so terrified of the loss of her that it was almost like I didn't quite believe that she was back. And that kind of informed the heart of this story, which was about this father who has that same experience that I had with his son, not a daughter, who gets very sick as an infant. And then, as the story goes, he is unable, in his mind anyway,
it's interesting,
to love that child again. Yeah. In that way that you need to.
It's interesting because you've pointed out that, and it's a father-son story, and it's beautifully written, that people looking for similarities in your own life as far as your own father, no, totally different personalities, that the connection is to your own life as far as your daughter is concerned.
It's not autobiographical except for that. And there are relatives here tonight who knew and loved my father, and I would be very remiss if I didn't say that my father is almost diametrically opposed to the father in this. My father, Amram, Ami Duchovny, was a sweet, gentle, loving, funny. They're both funny, but they're funny in different ways. Also known as Marty. So I can see where you might get confused and think that that's my father. That was bad of me to call him Marty, but I'm lazy with names.
Do you think, your father wrote his first novel late in his life, right?
72.
Yeah. So understanding different personalities, but yeah. Do you think there's something in there about the struggle to write and the struggles to write for the people in this book? Is there something that transferred over from your watching his experience to these characters in this
book? Well, I think that definitely informs. You know, I never think about these things. It's a very good question, and I'm not kissing your ass. It's a good question.
And shockingly, I'm fine with that answer. Yeah. Really, nothing more is a.
But as a writer, I didn't think that way. In retrospect, now that you ask me, I look at it as a reader.
Yeah.
And I think you're absolutely right. I think what informed that unconscious choice was, yes, I thought back on my father's life, and you know, you have in the book, you have a father who is a frustrated writer,
right.
And the son finds what he thinks is a novel, and it's actually a journal. And you have a son who finishes his father's novel, and it becomes a bestseller. So yes, it's a fantasy in a way. It's a fantasy of a father and a son connecting through, I guess, through ambition or through art or through things that they love. So I think yes, that's probably, you know, that's probably what drove it, but I never thought of it that way.
When you studied literature at Princeton, and then you got your master's at some place called Yale, so at that time, was this the dream? I'm going to be a writer. There are going to be books, one right after the other.
Ah, no. The dream the dream was to play for the New York Knicks.
There you go. Which, that's usually the path. You study literature at Princeton, and then at Yale, and then go play for the New York
Let me show you why that
Knicks.
Didn't happen.
Yeah.
That's not the only reason it didn't happen. Yeah, I think my dreams as a kid was to be any kind of professional athlete.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if it wasn't a basketball player, it was a baseball player, or, you know, panicking tennis. You know, like maybe I could be a tennis player. So, by the time I was in college, I kind of knew that wasn't going to happen. So I think by default, I always just thought of myself as a writer, probably because my father did, and my mother's a teacher. And I was always told to read a book. You know, if I was bored, my mother said, go read a book, you know. And it's funny, because my kids are on the computer, and I say, hey, you know, get off the computer and watch some TV.
There you go.
So, you know, do something that's good for you. Watch some TV. So times have changed a little bit. But I think I always would have said I was a writer. So when I was at Princeton, when I went to Yale, I thought I was going to get a PhD and then teach at the college level. And I thought I would have 3 or 4 months out of the year to write. You know, I would teach.
Right.
For 9 months, and then I would write. That was kind of the overall plan. But I'm not a planner, so there was no plan.
Now, this is a father-son story amongst many other stories in this book, using the vehicle, shall we say, of baseball. You played a lot as a kid. You talked about collegiate high school right here in the city, baseball and basketball. Is it? Very late on the applause,
wow.
Very late. In fact.
The Dutchman.
We are, I think we all knew that.
We had a mascot that had a peg leg. Not very intimidating.
No. At my college, we had Ben Franklin.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Let me put my spectacles on to shoot these free throws.
That's right. That's right. Right. One night before the big econ exam, he actually sat at half court during the national anthem with the old Samuelson economics textbook and actually read it during the national anthem. This is incredibly compelling stuff for the 92nd Street Y book.
You did?
No, the Ben Franklin.
Oh.
The Ben Franklin.
That Ben Franklin.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh.
But is there something about, we'll get to the importance of sports in 1 second in terms of growing up, but is there something that putting a book in a sports setting, does that allow for something as a writer that might not be there if you try to put it in a different setting?
Well, I know it. You know, I know it in my bones. I know how to play. I know how to talk about it. So there's that, mm-hmm. even though there's not a lot of it in there.
Right.
And we were talking earlier, you know, and this was written as a screenplay, and it's death to write a sports screenplay in Hollywood because they don't think it translates overseas. You know, nobody wants to see a baseball film in Japan. So, yeah, right? I mean, you guys are smarter than they are. You know, that's why it's a novel, because they don't want to see a baseball movie in Japan. So what was the question?
But did you,
Oh yeah, so why baseball? Well, or why sports? Because I know it, I love it, I know how to write about it. You know, honestly, it was just a conjunction of those story threads that came together. And then it was this idea that came to me that the father had come up with this harebrained idea that he couldn't die, right. wasn't going to die. Until the Sox won, then knowing he had lung cancer and was going to die, then this must be the year the Sox are going to win it all.
Right.
It just stands to reason, right? So he does something like he takes a bunch of Quaaludes and second all and like, hey, look, I didn't die. I told you I'm immortal until the Sox win. So this kind of, that was in there. And then, you know, the Bucky Dent thing, it all just kind of, you know, just wound around itself and became this story. And that was in like 2003, as I was saying, and then the Sox went and they won it in 2004, which was horrible. I mean, I watched in horror because the Yankees gave away a 3-game lead and then the Sox swept the Cardinals, and I just thought, there goes my movie forever.
This has nothing to do with rooting interests.
Oh, I didn't care.
Yeah,
I didn't care. I was fine. I was fine with the Sox winning, just not until I made my movie.
Right.
And I thought that's it. It's over. You know, nobody. The air was let out of the bubble. So, in a way, it's nice. It becomes an epilogue. You know, in this book, and it matters less that they won for a novel than for a movie. Even though I still think I can make the movie, but. It's my feeling that New Englanders actually miss their role as
right.
cursed.
Right.
Because at least then they were special.
Right. Right.
At least God was talking to them personally, saying, I hate you. But God was talking to them. Now it's clear that God has moved on.
Right. Or they still look at themselves that way, but having won 3 World Series in the last 10 years.
They're very confused.
Yeah. God's going to be with Cub fans, I think, for a while.
Yeah. I was actually asked early on when I was starting, when I showed the screenplay to the editors at Forrest Strauss Rowe, and they were like, could you do it in Chicago? You know, and it's a legitimate question because it's still you know, the Holy Grail over there. But I couldn't. It just, you know, because I didn't have the Bucky Dent story and I didn't have the title.
Wait, you just do a series of books like this, you know, one for Chicago, one for Boston.
What's the kid's name? It's like fucking Bartman. You could do that story.
Yeah, that's a whole other issue, how they treated that guy.
What's his first name? Steve?
Yes.
That's the next book, is Steve fucking Bartman.
You wrote a beautiful piece a few years ago in a book about coaches. Yeah. And I believe that coach is here tonight.
I think maybe Coach Burns is here. Are
Coach
you?
Burns, at a collegiate high school, David's basketball coach, a few years ago, one or two years ago.
Is Coach Burns here? No.
All right. David.
I take it back. I take it all back.
wasn't happy with the language.
He wouldn't have been happy with the language. He didn't like my long hair either.
Can you point to, you loved playing, you've talked about it.
I loved playing for Coach Burns, too.
Yeah,
yes.
And you're quite eloquent in talking about what he taught you.
Yeah.
Is there something, lessons learned beyond the court, beyond the diamond, because you played baseball as well, that you've applied in your life as an actor?
As an actor, you said?
Yeah.
Oh, as an actor.
I mean, in those kinds of settings, is there something to, or is it, am I making stuff
up? Well, I think I was attracted to acting when I realized that I wasn't going to be a professional athlete. Mm-hmm. Acting, and I don't know why you continue to laugh at that. acting was collaborative. Acting was a team. It is. The best actors are team players. And the best sets are collaborative organisms. And aside from the performative aspect of having that kind of buzz of, you know, here's the game. And you get the buzz when you're performing. It's a similar thing. So all those things reminded me of what I like to do, which was play those games. So mm-hmm. this was just another game without a ball.
Hmm.
I think I was attracted to that team. I didn't play solo sports. I didn't become a professional tennis player. This is not many people know this, but I. So there was that. I think I love to be in a team situation. So there's that. Other lessons, you know, it's always about resilience, and it's something that I try to teach my kids, and you know, it's something that we all try to teach our kids, and because life is hard, and you get knocked down all the time. So and you lose. You know, when you play sports, you get used to losing, which is a good thing. And that doesn't mean you're supposed to lose or you want to lose, but you realize that it happens. And just teach my kids resilience. And I tried to, I learned that because I apparently, and I don't remember, but I was a really bad loser and a really bad sport when I was young. And even when Coach Burns got me, I think I was pretty bad.
Mm-hmm.
And I my behavior was not good on the court, and I cursed, and I was bad. So I learned how to control myself, and I learned how to channel that. You know, I mean, there are stories of in my family, and my sister's here, but she's 6 years younger, so she probably doesn't remember, because most of the stuff where I was a real ass was with my older brother.
Mm-hmm.
There's a story, he played the flute, and there's a story of somehow my finger got in the flute. There's a story of me knocking all the chess pieces off the board, things like that. I know that my father, stopped playing stickball with me, and all his friends stopped playing stickball with me because I was such a horrible loser. Now, I'm a great loser now. Yeah. I can't imagine. In some ways, I can't relate to that kid. I don't know what his problem was. I mean, he had a lot of passion, and that's good. And I think that that's necessary, and it's okay to care that much. That's okay,
right.
But you also got to come back from losing.
What else do you recall about growing up in the home that you did growing up in New York City?
The home? I was like, I grew up in a home?
Yeah. Are there...
It's news to me.
Yeah.
My home?
Are there...
Yeah, well, we spent a lot of time in the park, you know. We spent a lot of time on 21st Street and 2nd Avenue, 20th Street and 2nd Avenue, and we spent a lot of time in Peter Cooper. These are places that you all probably know.
Right.
And a lot more time was unsupervised, you know, and this is, we all know this. I mean, it was different to grow up. As a parent, I've seen more games that my son has played than my dad ever did, and I don't say that to say that I'm a better dad. I think it makes me a worse dad. You know, it's like, you gotta give the kids some space.
Right.
Baseball is not life and death. I go to these kids' games and they're miserable.
Right. We know baseball is not life and death. Basketball is life and death.
Right.
That's a whole different
right.
story.
Yeah.
So what year do you get out of Yale?
I haven't. I didn't get my degree.
Okay, there you go.
Still working on it.
From the crack research I've done.
And here. I'm not the oldest one working on his degree either.
Yeah. So, but how much time is there between...
It's graduate humor. Graduate school humor. Big. It's going to be the big thing next year.
Yeah. Graduate school and literature humor.
Yeah.
Say no more. So you go, as I understand, as I've read, you try out for a beer commercial in 1987, having a degree from Princeton and a master's, or being at Yale.
Yeah.
Anybody whom you respect, friends, family, give you the, you know, Dave, what are you
doing? Oh, I didn't tell anybody.
Excellent.
Yeah. No, my acting was not something that I shared with people who I feared their censure about it. I mean, I was obviously doing something ridiculous.
In your own mind, or you thought this is how they would feel about it?
Both. You know, I wasn't sure what I was after. I wasn't sure what I was doing. I wasn't sure at all. Like I said, I don't plan. I wasn't sure. I was just compelled to do it, you know, compelled to figure this thing out a little bit. I think part of it was because I am temperamentally not suited to do it, and it was a challenge. You know, you hear actors always say, I was shy. But I was quiet. I was pretty quiet, and I am not temperamentally suited to being an extrovert that way, I don't think. And yet here I am, sitting, talking about myself. So there was a puzzle there that I wanted to get at. And I guess I just kept getting at it, and you know, until I worked. And I wasn't very good either. You know, I didn't have a natural game there, I don't think.
Right.
I had to kind of teach myself or figure out what the way I wanted to do it, the way I was going to do it. And that took some time.
Are there times, either before you go for this beer commercial or even after, where...
Lowenbrow.
Yeah. Where, for the record...
Let it be Lowenbrow.
Tonight, let it be Lowenbrow.
Tonight.
Yeah.
I don't think you can let it be Lowenbrow anymore. I don't think it's out.
Whether you get that reference is a kind of an age thing.
Yeah.
Are there times of is this going to work out?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I was in a sublet on 7th Street and 1st or Avenue A, and mm-hmm. I was subletting from a woman who was kind of a mythic. Unfortunately, she died quite young. Mary Maher was her name, and she was a literary agent. And I was subletting from her, and she had a pet tarantula. That was my one responsibility, was to care for a tarantula. How do you care for a tarantula? I still don't know.
Mm.
But what I did, what I had to do for this tarantula was I had to go to the pet store and buy crickets. So that's what the tarantula ate.
Mm.
So I would buy, I forget, 4 or 5 crickets, and you dump them in the... This is not the answer that you thought you were going to get.
No, that's quite all right. That's quite all right.
So I would dump them in the terrarium. Is that what it is? Dump them in there with the tarantula, and it was pleasant because it was New York City, in Alphabet City, and it was nasty. It was the early 80s. Nobody wanted to live there. I mean, I had a mouse give me a look that was like, to this day, scares the shit out of me. So.
Perhaps putting the mouse in the terrarium wasn't a good idea.
So with the 5 or 6 or a dozen crickets or whatever, I had to give this tarantula a month. At first, it was it sounded quite nice in the apartment because there was the sound of chirping. And I remember liking it and feeling like life was hopeful. And then the chirping got thinner and thinner as the month, until there was like one chirp.
Yeah.
And I remember having that thought. You asked me, did I ever think it wasn't going to work out? And I remember thinking, oh, God, I'm in a... one room with a tarantula and a cricket that's about to get eaten, and what am I doing?
Yeah.
So yeah, that's how it occurred to me.
Ah, the glamour of show business.
And so I moved to LA.
There you go. When we're in our 20s, each week or month when things are unsure seem like a lifetime. Obviously, yeah. When we look back on it, we say, oh, well, it was only a couple of years.
Yeah.
Now that we can look back on it, we can say it wasn't that long before, between that and working.
Before I was working.
And working consistently.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden being on a show
right.
that really catches fire.
Right.
Very few people in our lives will have that sensation
yeah.
of being in a sublet and then people walking down the street calling out your name.
Mm-hmm.
How does one keep one's feet on the ground when that's going on?
Well, I think that I was, I felt like I started late, as we've been saying. You know, I was doing something else, and
right.
I started acting when I was about 25, and then I started really trying to audition when I was about 26, 27, and then I moved to LA when I was about 28, 29, and then I got the X-Files maybe when I was 31. So I felt like I had a lot of catching up to do.
Mm.
But on the other hand, I was a man. You know, I wasn't a 21-year-old kid. I knew a little bit who I was. I knew what I wasn't. You know, it wasn't like I was 31, I was 32. You couldn't tell me I was something that I wasn't. I wasn't going to believe it. You know, I was not susceptible to that, I don't think. I mean, I'm sure, you know, I had moments of being an ass, you know, or you know, just getting egotistical from time to time, but I was formed, you know, I was a person, and partly because of my education, you know, but I was also my age. It would have been hard to turn me around. I felt the same. I have always felt the same. I've felt the same my whole life, really.
I'm always curious, when you talk to a musician who has produced wonderful music, do they know? When they've written the song, is there something that says, I think I got something here, or is it just too mysterious to really figure out this is going to be something that people like, this is something that people mm-hmm. are, well, we'll see. Mm-hmm. Is there a moment where you realize, I think we got something here with this show?
With the X-Files?
Yeah.
I don't know. I think I was just wanting to work and wanting to, you know, pay the rent. Mm-hmm. So I was just happy that it kept going. You know, the first, you know, you get picked up. You know, first your pilot gets picked up. That means you get to become a show, and then they pick you up for 12. You know, not 24. We pick you up for 12, and then oh, we picked you up for the back end, the whole season. You get 24. It's like, oh, we got picked up. We get picked up. It's like that's all I cared about. Like, let's get picked up, and then yeah, I don't know. I don't know when that moment was. It's so long ago, and it's been with me for so long that it's hard to remember when that shift occurred. But you know, I think, you know, oddly enough, because you know now everybody makes fun of the Golden Globes, but I, you know, we got nominated for a Golden Globe, and I thought, oh my God, we're good. You know? I think it was that, like we get to go to the award show. We get awards. You know, it was like it wasn't so much popularity out in the world as recognition from our peers, if that's what you call the Golden Globe.
I've heard you talk in some of the interviews for this book about the fact that The X-Files made you a better writer.
Yeah.
How so?
Well, because it's very plot-oriented, and I was more like Ted in the beginning of the book, in that I was coming from an academic environment where we weren't reading for plot at all, you know. It wasn't like, you know, hey, who can tell me what happened in Middlemarch? You get an A. If you can tell me. That's not what happens in graduate school.
Yeah.
You know, I'm bringing my Marxist dialectic to bear on this shit. That happens in graduate school. So, it's not about plot. It's not about what happens.
But you did bring the Marxist dialectic into the book in one place, where you talked about comparing the Marxists.
It's in my toolbox, man.
Yeah, in there. Now, so, don't want to give away, you know, spoiler alert.
Marxist dialectic.
Read the book. It's really terrific. But you put Karl Marx where in terms of?
The Marx Brothers?
Yeah. Or which character does it? I'm sorry, in the book.
Groucho.
Yeah.
Harpo.
Right.
Karl. Zeppo. Gummo.
Gummo. Gummo gets no respect.
No, he's a straight man. In all fairness, I have to say when I rip somebody off, I'm ripping off a great man. Harold Bloom referred to Karl Marx as the lesser Marx.
This was.
But he never ranked him like that. That was me. But in graduate school at Yale, Harold Bloom referred to Karl Marx as the lesser Marx, which is pretty brilliant.
Safe to say he was a mentor at Yale?
No.
Just.
No, but I was in his presence, you know, and I heard the man speak, and he supposedly graded my papers. But I also, as a graduate student, graded many papers, so I know who graded my papers.
He supposedly graded my papers. I think that means mentor.
But he, you know, he was just the largest mind I've ever sat near. Just full of the history of English literature in his mind. Just a phenomenal thing. Just crazy.
We'll be getting to some of your questions. I believe some cards are being passed around, and we'll get to your questions in just a little bit. Back to the writing. There was a book before the Bucky Dent book, which came out last year, mm-hmm. called Holy Cow.
Yeah.
By the way, also a baseball reference from the late, great Phil Rizzuto.
Yeah.
And it's terrific, it's very funny, and it's written with the voice of a cow.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to demystify things too much, but you want to write, and the idea comes to you how to make this in the voice of a cow.
Oh. No, it was the voice of the cow kind of appeared to me in the sense that I was driving, and I thought, you know, if I were a cow, I would try to get to India. That's just how it occurred to me. It was like, so the voice came to me fully formed. It was very commonsensical. I was like, that makes sense. So it was a commonsensical cow,
mm-hmm.
and I was like, that's funny. Stay with it. Are there other animals that might want to get other places? Yeah. Pig would want to go to Israel. That's good. What else? Nothing else, nothing. There's no other animal. Shit. Gotta have three. Two's not good enough. Turkey goes to Turkey. He thinks that the country's named after him. They love him. Okay.
It seems like it would probably be as much fun to write as it was to read.
It was fun. I was bemoaning the fact that I wasn't writing fiction. This was a few years ago, and I was beating myself up for not doing it. And I thought, well, I have that holy cow idea that I had pitched to Disney and Pixar, who didn't want the fabulous. They didn't want the pig circumcision scene.
Seen one pig circumcision, seen them all.
Yeah. So I just thought, and in a way, not a plan. Sometimes I make good decisions by mistake. And this was a good decision in that it was a... it was a voice that was very free and liberated. The cow voice was very. It was a teenagery. It was female. It was far from me that I could play, and I wouldn't feel the onus of like, oh, here's a serious goddamn novel coming out of me. Take it, world. You know, take me seriously, world. I'm not just an actor.
Right.
So I felt free, and I was just, it just opened up, like I could write it. It just came out, you know, I just heard this voice and it came. So the smart decision that I did not make, but made me in a way, was write in the voice of a cow, and took all the pressure off. Right. You know, this, if I tried this first, I think I would have felt more pressure, because this is more of a proper novel, and it might have been more difficult the first one out of the gate.
Did you have that feeling through the years? Obviously, things are going great during X-Files. You do movies, you do TVs, you do Californication. Mm-hmm. Is there some notion of... all joking aside, was there some notion of, I studied writing, it's in my family, I saw my father struggle. At some point, I got to get to this.
I saw it through the lens of writing screenplays. I didn't see it through writing fiction. I saw myself as a writer, and I wrote some X-Files. And
how was that?
I was great.
Yeah.
I was. No. I'm not saying that.
No, I mean that. Was
not,
there?
I'm not saying that the show. My show was great.
The experience was enjoyable.
Yeah. I said to Chris Carter, I said, if I write a show, can I direct it? And he was like, sure. So I went, and it turned out to be a baseball one too. So it was like. So I can say baseball has been very, very good to me.
There you go.
But that was another one where it was all these things that were happening. It was kind of a synchronicity. It was the year when Sosa and McGuire were hitting a lot of home runs.
Sure. 1998.
Yeah. Because we shot in 99. So there was this home run race going on, and I was reading the LA Times. There was a article on this guy named Bauman. I can't remember his first name, Joe maybe, and he played for the Roswell Rockets. And in 1947, which is the year of the Roswell crash and the year Jackie Robinson breaks the color barrier in major leagues, Bauman hits 72 home runs. Right. So I was like, he's an alien. So
I think we could all see that coming.
Not a cow.
Yeah, right.
He's an alien. But then I made him black, and I thought that was the good move.
Uh-huh.
Because I made him, you'll have to see the episode to understand, but it was really, I mean, in all seriousness, I thought that was my kind of piece on race and racism uh-huh. in America, in the guise of this kind of lighthearted baseball episode.
Right. Might be the understatement of the night to say that the series, The X-Files, inspired a bit of passion.
Yeah.
And passionate fans. Can you give us an example of two? One more thing on The X-Files. Can you give us an example or two of perhaps how that passion was exhibited to you, either through things sent to you or names not important, obviously. Did it get to a point where it was, I think we have an X-Files bobblehead doll coming up here.
Throw it. Spaceball. Throw it.
Please be seated. Please be seated. I'm a professional. We are here on Fox Mulder bobblehead night.
This is not a bobblehead.
Oh, sorry.
But the resemblance is uncanny. You collect these?
A few. Yeah.
No, I don't think you sound crazy enough. But thank you for that. No, I'm kidding. I'm not going to do that.
Is there a point where it gets...
Thank you for your watch.
No, be my guest.
I don't know. There's not been a lot of crazy stuff that has happened with the X-Files that way. I think the passion of the fans is genuine for the show. And I get it, because I agree. I think the show's terrific, and I think it has legs, you know. So, at first, the first year, I felt it was my responsibility. Well, first of all, I was amazed that I was getting fan letters. So, you know, they'd like give me my fan letters at the end of the week, and they'd come up to Vancouver. And they'd give Jillian and I our fan letters at the end of the week, and I would go home and I'd try to answer them. Aw. mostly because there weren't that many, right? So I could I could do it. But there was a lot of S-A-S-E's. You know what that is?
Apparently not.
If you're a real fan, you know that's a self-addressed stamped envelope.
Ah, I got it.
So, a lot of $1 bills
yeah.
that I pocketed. So, in all seriousness, there were some disturbing letters that I read. And some sad, sad stories that I heard that the aliens did.
Mm-hmm.
So. But people do think that I have special knowledge. That somehow I have been entrusted with the special knowledge of the alien stuff. And I don't, but I think it's the reason why the show translated in all countries. You know, it was a show that exported so strongly because the belief in other worlds and, right. and other beings is not dependent on the English language, you know, and it's universal. So.
And also, good is good. It holds up. I watched.
Well, yes, that's the other thing. People used to ask me, you know, why is the show a success? And I'd say like an asshole. I'd say, because it's good, you know. But that's true. Yeah. You know, it's had really good writers and we had good directors and we made a good show.
Yeah. I watched the Peter Boyle episode.
Yeah, Peter Boyle.
I watched the Peter Boyle episode the other night. He's just terrific.
Peter Boyle is
just great.
Yeah.
It's great.
Yeah. He was fun to work with, and I was such a big fan of his.
We have some questions from the audience, so here we go. Do you feel as though writing fiction is a way to escape your reputation as the X-Files actor, a space where you find relief from your fame, or a forum to express yourself? That's a lot.
I have to choose one?
Yeah.
So you asked me a question, but you gave me two answers, and yeah. I have to choose one. I don't think I like that. I can try to explain something, which is I don't think of myself as being on the X-Files. In my daily life, I don't wake up in the morning, and when I look in the mirror, I don't see the guy in the X-Files. I don't think about the X-Files unless I'm doing the X-Files, and then I'm doing a part on a show that is eventually going to be called the X-Files, but I'm involved in acting in it, which is a different process. Mm-hmm. So it has no reality to me. I understand that it has reality to other people, but my reality has always been one where I was going to create a bunch of things on the earth, and this is one of them. And we started to make music, and we got some of our crazy fans right here. So I don't know how to answer that question without sounding like an asshole by saying I just don't think of myself that way. I'm not being arrogant.
Mm-hmm.
It's not inside me. It's outside me.
Who is your favorite character in all of literature?
No applause.
And fiction. Delayed.
I'm sorry if that's not the answer.
Delayed response.
But it's
delayed
just,
response.
Just not.
Who is your favorite character in all of literature and fiction? Or maybe one or two.
Wow. That's a hard one. Oh, gosh, I don't know.
Let me ask you this.
I can't answer that.
The writer Paul Auster, the great writer Paul Auster, talks about growing up, and I think when he was 15, happening upon Crime and Punishment, Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment.
Mm-hmm.
And he was a ball player, too. Played baseball.
Paul Auster?
Yeah, loved it. And Crime and Punishment, and it's like before and after. Changes
right.
his life.
Right.
Is there something from, you said you're reading books all the time growing
yeah.
up.
I remember getting into John Berryman's poems. I had a paper to write in high school, and for some reason it was on Berryman, or I chose Berryman. Uh-huh. And he's very well respected now. At that point, he was kind of well respected, but now he's kind of in the pantheon, but then he wasn't. And I just remember really being taken over by his voice, you know, and I can still hear it sometimes.
That's great. Is there any
Thomas Hardy said, and this I think this is good advice for writers, is that you're lucky if your first hero as a writer is a good writer but not a great writer, you know, because it's impossible to overcome a great writer. They'll just crush you because right. he's too good. But if you love a good writer, you can almost see yourself getting there, and it's inspiring rather than cowing you.
Steven Van Zandt tells a story about growing up in New Jersey as a rock and roller in the mid-60s and seeing the Beatles on Sullivan and saying, well, I can't do that.
Right.
But he says, seeing the Stones a bit later,
he said, I could do.
That I could do.
Right, right.
And I love the fact that I just stole his story and got a laugh out of it. How great is that?
You shouldn't even say his name next time.
That's right. When I was growing up, is there any Hank Moody in Bucky fucking Dent? Attitude, outlook, beliefs, morality?
Oh, again, when I wake up in the morning, I don't look in the mirror and go, good morning, motherfucker. Although maybe I should.
I've done about 40, 50 nights here at the Y, and suffice it to say, first time I've heard that on the
But, I don't know. I can't answer that.
Anything in particular that we haven't talked about that show that much? Anything in particular that you really enjoyed about that character?
Well, the show itself, I loved working with those actors, and we... We had a great time making that show, and you know, Pam Adlon, who plays, I refer to her as Cokie Smurf, which was mine. I made that up. I will take credit for that. She has her own show now called Better Things, and I just did a little cameo with her and Lenny Kravitz like 2 weeks ago when we wrapped Aquarius. So I'm so excited. Pam, she's got a voice, she's got a point of view, she's a single mom with three kids. It's a show that is gonna find a place because it has a voice. So I'm excited for Pam. Loved working with Evan Handler, Tasha McElhone, Maddie Martin. I think Coach Burns didn't show up, but I think Maddie Martin, my TV daughter, is probably here. Are you here, Maddie? Well, it's enough that I love them.
Just if we have that situation one more time tonight, I would just ask someone, a benevolent person. Probably should be someone from one of the back rows. That's kind of the point. She's here. Excellent.
Why so quiet? What? I hear her now. I heard that voice. Thanks for coming.
Yeah.
No, really.
I see.
See you afterwards.
She's reading the book.
Well, Maddie is a terrific actress and such a special person, and I believe is going to be a writer because she has a point of view and she has great intelligence. And you know, she auditioned when, how old were you, Maddie, when you auditioned?
14.
That voice. She was 14 and she was so poised and so, there was just no question. Like, when she left the room, there was no question that she was going to be that character. And I spent the next 7 seasons trying to make her forget a line. She's so relaxed, so good, so born to be an actress. I'd never worked with anybody quite so seamlessly perform. And and if she's not here, she's going to be sad she wasn't here. But I did get you one time, didn't I?
Yes.
Look at that line reading. You can't do that. It's just perfect. It's just perfect. I got her one time. But I would try. I would try and make her screw up. It was not possible.
So she was 14 and trying out for like this national show on television.
Yeah.
When I was 14, I pretty much needed directions home.
Well, Maddie, forgive me for telling this story too. Maybe you're going to wish that you didn't come. But the scripts for Californication could be pretty filthy and funny, but filthy. And Maddie, at 14 and 15 and 16, she would sit there with her earbuds in, listening to music. And then her mom was at the table read and would give her the signal when her scene came up. And she would read her scene, and then she'd put her earbuds back in.
Pretty good.
Is that true, Maddie?
Yeah.
Killing me. You're killing me.
We have a couple more. How has your perspective of the X-Files, and indeed Hollywood, or your perspective on the X-Files and Hollywood, changed with the benefit of time?
Is time a benefit? Changed. X-Files and Hollywood?
How has your perspective of the X-Files and indeed Hollywood changed?
Oh, you had to go with the indeed. That makes
sense. That's right.
Makes me think you didn't quite trust the transition. Well, I think I talked about the X-Files. Yeah. Hollywood is kind of hard to grasp in that way. I mean, there's certainly been times when I wish I would have done more movies or done movies that I was close to doing, and would have been unhappy about that, but. All in all, I feel like both in TV and film, I've been able to do quite a bit, and I continue to feel kind of a nice challenge about the whole thing. So I don't know what you mean by Hollywood. That's another thing. I don't exactly know what that means. You'd have to be more specific. The town? No. Hmm.
BFD.
Yeah. Yeah.
BFD. Yeah. Exemplified, according to the question, exemplified how life belongs to the losers. How does David Duchovny define a loser? Interesting question.
That's, that is, it's what being a human being is. You know, we're born in time, right? We have to die. We all lose in the end, right? So we're joined by that's our common bond. That's the love between us, as we all understand how hard it is to go through this thing together. So I think victory in many ways can separate people, you know, but I think loss can really bring them together. So I think that it's our shared humanity is in acknowledging that it's hard out here.
Mm-hmm. There's an old adage in this.
Yeah, losers.
There's an adage in the sports journalism world about the more interesting story is almost always in the losing locker room.
Mm-hmm.
That there are honest emotions in both, but for some reason they're a little bit more honest.
Well, I mean, it's great to win too. Sure. Yeah, winning is great. I'm not saying don't go for it. You know, that's That's the other thing. It's like you, and I tell my kids, you know, when they play games, it's like if you tried hard, it's a cliche, you know, you'll be able to sleep tonight, you know, but if you didn't and you lost, then you're going to stay up, so.
This goes on for a bit, but stay with me for a second. No, it's an interesting question, and seriously written. It quotes you,
but
I'm not.
It's typed. How did that happen?
Hold on. And then there's this. It quotes you, I'm not a planner, and there was no plan, quoting you.
I said that tonight.
Yeah.
This is happening in real time.
I think that was right after you said the thing about looking at yourself in the mirror. Yeah, but let's go back to that quote. With regards to this comment, what advice might you have for a young woman who has never been a, quote, planner, so that, as you have so successfully done, can see her dream of being a writer come to fruition? Which I think is
Well, I'm glad that you asked about writing, because I didn't know what I was going to say throughout most of that question. I honestly think that writing is all about discipline. And I'll actually, since I'm being asked to generalize, and I'm loath to do it, yet happy to. I think much of life is about discipline, or success in life. You know, we're talking about losers, winners. I think that writing is an act of discipline. And probably any art form that you want to do is an act of discipline, of doing it. The shitty thing about acting is it's hard to act when nobody's asking you to do it. But you can write every day. You can sit there and write every day, and you must. I think that's not a plan. That's just a discipline. I think there's a difference between planning and discipline, and I'm on the side of discipline.
So does that make what you say about acting? Does that make when you are in a situation, TV, movie, whatever, that feels good? That's a good experience. That's a collaborative experience,
yeah.
Like a great basketball team.
Yes.
Are there moments of enjoy it now, because you know this business can be crazy and
oh sure
next week who knows?
Yeah of course, but no, that's not human nature. You know, like they say, enjoy it now, guys, enjoy it now, because you know not always gonna be. Yeah, they wouldn't
Sounds
say that all the time if it was human nature to actually enjoy it now.
Yeah. Sounds good.
Well, it's the truth, but it's still impossible.
Right. Couple more. Do you have any plans on directing another movie in the future?
Yes.
I really enjoyed House of D.
Thank you. Yeah, I love directing. I love it almost more than anything. I just directed an Aquarius, the 12th episode of this coming season. Thank you. And I hadn't directed in about 3 years since I'd done the last Californication. And I remembered how much I loved it. And Maddie, was I okay as a director? You can say that?
Yes.
It's like, how many times can you go back? Every time.
Let's go back to the well.
She's perfect.
Yeah, yeah. The delayed response. Last question from the audience.
No, that was timing. That wasn't
timing.
Delayed.
Sorry.
That was comic timing.
I didn't take that. I'm sorry.
You can't learn it.
No.
It's too late.
Do you ever have an answer to the question, quote, what would I do if I weren't afraid, unquote? Or are you simply just never afraid?
Me?
I was just going to say, well, I thought.
Is it the you is me?
I
or
believe,
is it the you one?
I believe the question, yes, I
it's
believe the
me.
Question is for
it's
you.
It's for
yes.
me. Oh, I'm afraid.
Maybe I got these wrong. Maybe these were all for me.
Yeah.
That would be embarrassing.
I'm afraid all the time. I mean, I was afraid to come out with it. I don't want to be made fun of, you know? I don't want to be humiliated. I don't want to be spoken badly of. I don't want people not to like me. I'm a human being, so. There's a fear when you put yourself out in public in any creative endeavor. that that's going to happen. You're going to be embarrassed, or they'll laugh at you, or they'll make fun of you. So I think every performer, writer, creative artist has that in them. It's why I don't generally read reviews, because I'll just remember the really bad ones. I won't remember the good ones. But I remember some. I still remember bad ones from early on. So, you know, and when I do look at myself in the mirror, that's what I hear. Mm. So, there's a lot of fear, but there's less. I think as you get older, there's less, and I think it has to do with. Again, coming back to losing, I think, okay, here's the story. I got it. If you bullshit enough, eventually you get to the point. If you walk away with anything tonight, if you bullshit enough, eventually you'll have something to say. I was working up in Montreal, Canada.
Thank you.
It's on the same continent. And yet it's a whole other country. So I was working up there, and House of D came out, and House of D had mixed reviews, and I knew that because people told me. I wasn't reading them, but people were telling me they were mixed. And when they say mixed, they mean bad. No, they were mixed. They were mixed. They were just mixed. So, you know, there's always the friend that says, hey man, I don't know what the New York Times is thinking. That's enough. That will do me for the rest of my life, thank you. So, I was up in Canada, and my driver, I was acting in a movie, and the guy who drove me to set, he didn't speak much English. It was he was a French native French speaker, and the movie came out in Canada when I was there, just a couple weeks after it came out here, and he opened up the review on my seat, so I could not escape it, but clearly he didn't read it because he wouldn't have opened it up. He would have done everything he could so that I couldn't see it. So I look at this, and the headline is Duchovny's House of D gets an F. An F. And then I was like, an F? Whoa. I was thinking, an F? No, it's a competently made film. It's not Ed Wood, you know. It's not an F. I know it's not an F. You can give it a D if you really seriously hated it, but you can't give it an F. So my guard is up. And then the first line is, maybe David Duchovny's brain was abducted by aliens. You know, and you laugh, but it's painful. Especially when it happens, right? They take it out through the nose. So I completely had an out-of-body experience, like a shame experience. You know, when you're just terribly shamed, my ears felt hot, and I got to my trailer, and I couldn't stop thinking about this. And then I had this moment where I was like, well, you know, they hired me to be an actor on this movie. I can't feel sorry for myself. I've got to go do my job. Some other director, no doubt better than me, is waiting for me to go out there and do my job. So I was like, I sucked it up, and I was like, I'm gonna be a pro. I'm gonna go do my work. Like, I'll take pride in being a pro today. I don't know what kind of work I did. I was completely outside myself. And then that was a Friday, and then I woke up on Saturday, and I was really happy. And I couldn't figure it out, because I was remembering that review. And I was like, why am I happy? And then I realized, what was the question? It was about fear, right? We're there. My whole life, I'd been terrified of getting an F, because I thought it would kill me. And I woke up on that Saturday having gotten an F and I was still alive. And I was like, oh, I'm free. So you asked about like fear and like, does it ever get any better? And I think with age, with experience, you take some shots and you realize you can survive and that even an F from a nasty reviewer who says your brain was taken by aliens. I remember it, obviously, right? And that's why I don't read them. I survived, and I get to continue to do other things. I get to continue to work. So that would be the answer to that question. And that reviewer is here tonight. Will you stand up, please? She knows who she is.
We'll leave on one last note. One of the beauties of YouTube is that you can go back. You can go back
tell you right now, no.
And watch something that's really special.
What is
the spots on the Larry Sanders show? Are great, and obviously at this time, a happy memory. Sad time.
Yeah. Gary was a great friend, and in ways that are very personal, and he was an extremely generous person of his friendship, but also of his talent, which was huge, and people, if they care to, they'll understand the kind of disseminating influence that he's had on American comedy through people like Judd Apatow, Jake Kasdan, numberless people. But because he was never one to take credit like that, it's not out there. But you ask these people, and they will say he's their father. He's their comedic father. But that's just what he did. I mean, as a person, he was that generous as well. And, you know, he really, I always thought I was funny, and I was on this show called The X-Files, which wasn't funny. And I was like, I want to be funny. You know, I'm gonna... People think I'm like, you know? I was jonesing to be funny, and I've, forgive me, you've probably heard the story because I've told it a number of times, but I loved the Larry Sanders Show, and I recommend it to anybody because so many shows are derived from it, and he was ahead of the curve with all the reality stuff and people playing themselves and all the stuff that we take for granted is just part of the culture, and he was doing it first. And I got a little part to come down and do not the one where I was doing this, but this was before that, and I came down and I get bumped from I'm supposed to be on his talk show and I get bumped by no longer funny Bill Cosby, goes on too long, so. So I got bumped because Bill Cosby talks too much. And then I get pissed. And I say something like, there better be a huge fucking fruit basket in my hotel room. So we did a take, and I had never met Gary. And we did a take, and it was cut. And you're me, and Gary would do this. He'd go. How old are you? And I said, 32 or 33 or whatever I was. He goes, what took you so long? You know, it was like somebody touching you on the head with a magic wand. You know, it was like, it's for somebody like that to recognize in such a short, you know, one take. That's what he would do. He'd recognize a spirit. He'd recognize a talent, or he'd recognize humor, really. So as I said, I thought of myself as funny, and So did Gary. And we were great friends ever since then.
I'm always intrigued with people who are in the arts about the notion of tentacles. And that
what?
Tentacles. Stay with me here.
No.
No, it's a good thing. It's
I'm
a good
afraid.
Thing. It's a good thing that you never really know whose lives you're going to touch. Mm. And you never really know, for example, some 15-year-old kid somewhere in the United States tonight might happen upon that bit on the Larry Sanders show. And
on YouTube.
And see it for the first time.
Yeah.
Or an X-Files episode, or Californication.
Right. Well, I hope not if he's
well. Very, very progressive 15-year-old.
Yeah.
Or, hopefully, pick up Holy Cow,
yeah,
which is terrific, and this new book. You've given people a lot of joy through the TV shows, the movies, and now these books, and we thank you for that.
Thank you.